Hallelujah. In this our season of power, God is said to do something unique in your life. I have titled this message, Praise and Thanksgiving, the Highway to Higher Levels. Praise and Thanksgiving, the Highway to Higher Levels. You are going higher in Jesus' name. Before the end of this year, you will find that place. You will find that higher place that God has ordained for you to be. Hallelujah. Men and women will see you and you say, take me to your church. Hallelujah. Because of what God is doing in your life and my life. Amen. The highway to higher levels. Praise and thanksgiving. I want us to look at our first scripture in Psalm 100. Verse 4. But actually, Psalm 100 itself is a psalm of thanksgiving. But I want to lay emphasis on the verse 4. It says, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving. That means that wherever we come before the presence of God, either in your own private home, in your prayer closet, driving to work, in the shower, cooking, doing the dishes, cleaning, feeding the baby, or in the shopping mall, wherever you are, you can enter into the courts of God. Hallelujah. It does not have to be within the four walls of a building to enter into the presence of God. Remember, God is always with you. He is always with us, wherever we go. Why? Because Christ Jesus has now come to take residence in your life. He's come to take residence in your life. So wherever you are, you can commune with God. You can communicate with God because he is your father and you are his child. Amen. The Bible is encouraging us this morning that enter into his gates with thanksgiving. And into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. The disciples, the apostles, they were ordinary men. They were uneducated men. They were fishermen. But when they contacted the power of God, their lives were transformed. Hallelujah. The power of God has the effect to transform our lives. Nobody contacts the power of God and remains the same. Hallelujah. So the psalmist is encouraging us this morning to enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his court with praise. Very often, when we want to pray, we have a long shopping list, myself included. But the best way to access the power of God, the best way to cause God to move on your behalf, is first of all, to come within the courts of God with praise and to enter his courts with thanksgiving and to be thankful to God, to be thankful to him. There are many things that God has done for you and for me. So many things. The fact that you're not 6 feet under this morning, that one alone, is enough for you to be thankful to God. Jesus came and he paid the price. He paid the penalty for our sin. That is something that we have to be thankful to God for. Once we were in bondage, we were in bondage, in slavery to sin, and we were under a master called the devil because of the sin of our forefather Adam. But Christ came to our rescue. Hallelujah. Christ came to our rescue. He broke the chains of our life. He delivered us by going onto the cross. Because God required something. He required a sacrifice to atone for our sins. And Christ came to pay the penalty for our sins. And by the shedding of his blood and the death on the cross, The shackles were broken off your life and off my life. And now we have been adopted into the family of God. Hallelujah. You are now a child of God because you have been bought and redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. It is good to have a shopping list, but it is best to come to God with a heart of gratitude. It is best to come to God with a heart of gratitude. And when you come to God with a heart of gratitude, with a heart that says, Lord God, I give you praise. I thank you for watching over my life. I thank you that I was not run over. I thank you that that disease did not kill me. I thank you for saving my life. I thank you for giving the name of Jesus. Because the Bible said that the name of the Lord is a mighty tower. The righteous run into it and they are saved. The name of the Lord is a mighty tower. Hallelujah. The thing that depresses people cannot depress a child of God. That is not to say that we do not have challenges. We are not exempt from difficulties or challenges. But the good news is that we have Christ on our side. He has won the battle for us. Amen. He has fought the battle for us. Sometimes all you need to say is that Jesus. Jesus. It was the great songwriter Ron Canole who was involved. Just a bit of digression here. He was on a flight with his son and he met with an accident. And his only son, as he put it, before he knew it, in the he had a plane crash and his son was lifeless. He couldn't do anything. And even he himself was very injured. When we look at his son was lying there lifeless. He couldn't pray. He couldn't do anything. He said all he could do was to mention the name of Jesus. 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 And the son who was lying there lifeless, tears began to come out of his eyes. And he opened his eyes. The name of Jesus carries so much power. If you could not pray, if you couldn't say anything, but you have the name of Jesus. At the mention of Jesus, the Bible said that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus is Lord. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful to him and bless his name. Bless the name of the Lord. Sometimes we just need to bless the name of the Lord. Because there's no other name. There's no other name. There's no other name given amongst men by which men can be saved. We shall go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 from verse 15 to 19. See that no one renders evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good both for yourselves and for all. Verse 16 says, rejoice always. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. Is it possible to rejoice always? Yes, it is. Sometimes the pressures of life want to squeeze you. The pressures of life come so hard. Sometimes the fire gets so intense that it becomes so difficult for the flesh to rejoice. But guess what? Your spirit man is what is who is able to rejoice even in that intensity of the fire. The flesh, natural as it is, has got its limitations. But your spirit man has no limitations. Why? Because the Spirit of God in you is not fused with your spirit man. And the Spirit of God has no limitations. Hallelujah. Rejoice always. It is possible to rejoice always. Not by your flesh, but your spirit man can rejoice. In the midst of the trial, in the midst of the heat, in the midst of the fiery trials, of the temptations, of the distress that you're going through. Your spirit man, you can command your soul. You can command your spirit that rejoice in the Lord your God. Hallelujah. That's what David was able to say. Why are you cast down, oh my soul? Rejoice in the Lord. Hallelujah. Not your flesh, but your spirit man can rejoice. Because your spirit man carries Christ in you. Hallelujah. So sometimes when you feel that the heat is on, when you feel that there's nowhere out, when you feel that your back is against the wall, you can command your spirit man that arise within me and give glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. And God, by his power, will energize you.
Luke chapter 17, verse 11 to 15. There was a time that Christ, during his earthly ministry, he came across 10 lepers. Now it happened as he went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Verse 12, please. Then as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." So when he saw them, he said to them, "Go, show yourself to the priest." And so it was that as they were cleansed. Now the story has it that lepers, as we all know, are not allowed to live among the populace. So they are banished. They are outcast. The Bible said they were far off, but they saw Christ. You know, there's no man that encounters Jesus and remains the same. But even these lepers, who were social outcasts, who were not regarded anything, they had an encounter with the Master, the Creator of all things. And their story changed. The Bible said that they lifted their voice and they called unto him that have mercy on us. And Christ instructed them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." The story has it that they went and did as he commanded them. As they were going, the Bible said that they were cleansed. Hallelujah. Amen. Obedience brings blessings of God. Hallelujah. They were cleansed. But what happened? When they were cleansed, 10 of them went. But as they went, one of them came back. We know the story. One of them came back. And what did he do? He came to give glory unto the Lord. Why? He has remembered that Christ has changed his story. Christ has accepted him. Hallelujah. Amen. Even though he was a leper. But Christ did not look at his leprosy. He looked at him as a human being. And Christ touched his life. Christ touched his life. He came to give glory. And then the Lord said, "We're not 10 here. Where are the 9? You will not be among the 9.
Amen.
You will not be amongst the 9.
Amen.
It is true that you're not lepers. But if you look at your life, if you really take stock of your 9, verse 17, talking about praise and thanksgiving honors God. As we saw in the case of the lepers. "To you, all my strength, I will sing praises. For God is my defense, my God of mercy." This is the psalmist here. "To you, all my strength, I will sing praises. For God is my defense, my God of mercy." Our God is a God of mercy. Our God is a God of mercy. He is your strength. The Bible said that when I am weak, then I am strong. Hallelujah. Your God is a God of mercy. And he will send you strength from Zion. Even in this season of power, when you conquer the power of God, you will conquer the strength of God. Because the power of God equates the strength of God. That is why the apostles are educated and learned according to the social classification problem, they were at the bottom. But when that power of God came upon them, they were, you know, people that transformed their generation. Even kings have to listen to them. Hallelujah. That's what the power of God does in our lives. We shall have a look at Psalm 146, verse 2. "While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being." My friend, whilst you still have the breath of God in you, sing praises unto God. While you have breath in you, sing praise to God. While I live, I will sing praise to the Lord. I will sing praises to the God, to God, my God, while I have my being. You know, when the Lord calls you home, that time you're just going to be in His presence. But while we are alive, let us sing praises unto Him. In Exodus chapter 15, verse 11, you know, the people of God, it was prophesied that they will go into a foreign land and be taken as slaves. But a time will come that God Himself will bring them out. And we see that Israel went into Egypt. And, you know, a Pharaoh came that didn't know much about them, because the one that was there from the beginning passed on, and another Pharaoh came. And then he didn't know them very much. He began to, you know, enslave them. He began to make their life so miserable. We know the story. But God saw from heaven. They cried out to God, and God heard from heaven. And He came down to deliver them. God heard their cry. You know, man may not hear your cry. Man may not see your tears. Man may not see your affliction. Man may not see your misery. But God, who loves you and gave His Son for you, He sees from heaven. No matter what man is doing, no matter what the enemy is doing against you, God, who is for you, He sees from heaven. God saw from heaven, and He came down to deliver them. So they came out of Egypt with an outstretched arm. But as soon as they came out of the Red Sea, we know the story. Miriam took the tambourine, and she said in verse 11, "Who is like you, O Lord? Among the gods, who is like you? Glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders. Amongst the gods, who is like you? Who is like the God of life gates? Amongst the gods, who is like the God of life gates? Glorious in holiness, fearful in praises, doing wonders." God is doing wonders in your life. You need to give Him praise. So we look at 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 15. 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 15. "Therefore I will give praise to you, O Lord, among the Gentiles, and sing praises to your name. Please, in your office, wherever you work, at the college, at the university, the summit," he's saying, "I will give thanks to you amongst the Gentiles." That's amongst the people who do not know God. So wherever you are, do not let anybody silence you. Do not let anybody put any hindrance in your way from praising the Lord. David said, "I will give thanks to you, O Lord, amongst the Gentiles. Do not be ashamed of the name of the Lord." Hallelujah. Praise your God. Do a dance in your office. Let them call me crazy. But say, "Yes, I am crazy for Jesus." Hallelujah. Sometimes, you know, you get to the office and you are whistling. "Who is like unto thee, O Lord? Who is like unto thee?" But I'm whistling. I say, "Oh, what, are you singing Cephas?" And I say, "I'm just singing praises." "Oh, what is that? Is that a just?" I say, "Yes, it is. Just sing praises unto God. After all, we are living in the realm of freedom of worship. Just worship your God. Be free to praise your God." Hallelujah. I remember a few years back, my very good pastor friend from France came to visit me, and we went to the bull ring. And right at the bull ring, we went to Nando's. And he just started, "Bon, bon, bon again, praise God and bon." And the two of us were singing. People were looking at us very strangely. And we're just praising God. We cast our minds back, and we saw where we were. How he used to, you know, have to take a few shots of alcohol to deal with certain situations. And one day, God invaded his life. He gave his life to Christ. Even though he had a plan, he had his own plan, but God redirected his course. He went to Bible college. He he became a minister of the gospel. And God reunited us again. We were just praising God. And we were singing that song. You know, born again. Praise God. And people were just walking by. They thought we were crazy. But we were not crazy. We were just appreciating God. We were just remembering where God brought us from. We were just remembering how God delivered us. Hallelujah. Yeah. You know, as a young person, I come from a fishing village. The other day I was showing the brother, I used to go fishing, and in the middle of the night, pitch dark, they would drop me in the sea. They would drop me in. We used to have outboard motors. Those of you are familiar with that kind of thing. And they would deep sea, they would drop me in the sea. And then they will give me a torchlight. I'll hold that torchlight. And when the fishermen cast the net, and they come, because it is pitch dark, they need to see where the boy that floating thing is, so that they can, you know, catch them. So I will drop in the sea there. As a little young teenager, you know, only God set me from, he drove the sharks away from that time. Can you imagine? It's only God. But this day God is helping me just to see how God had a plan for my life. I could have been meat, I could have been a good dinner for a shark. In that sometimes even a whole ship can come because we are just a little outboard motor canoe. You know, there's nothing, we don't have anything. Pitch darkness. But God preserved my life. I lived in London, I was worshiping in the church, and I used to ride a bicycle on a very busy A road. That is called Old Kent Road. That leads to Dover. I used to ride on this bicycle, and I was living in the house of one, you know, Nigerian doctor. One is a simple, I'm fearful for you. I used to put the high visibility thing across like that with my helmet. I used to ride that bicycle. In the distance, maybe like from here to Wolverhampton. In winter, there's no pavement. I'll ride the bicycle on the same road as the trucks. Very busy road, a road that leads to Dover. You can imagine how busy that road is. I used to ride that bicycle to church and back. And I used to ride that bicycle to the city of London to do cleaning in the morning and back. How I wasn't run over is only God. It's only God that I wasn't run over. By a lorry, it's only God. In winter, when it is dark, it's only God. So we need to sometimes sit down and look at your life and begin to give thanks to God. Begin to give praise to God. I may not have millions in the bank accounts. I may not have a big mansion, but it's okay. God loves me. Today, He is taking care of me. There was an incident at work, and I had an injury. Actually, it was a head injury, and that thing could have been so severe that I may have to be off work for several months. But then again, God preserved my life. God preserved my life. I drive every day of the week, 5 days a week. I drive on M54. M7, M6, no, not M7, M54, M6, M5, 2 M4. It is not God's will, but it is the mercy of God. It is the mercy of God. So friends, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know your challenges, but God is with you. God is on your side. Engagement, and we said that sister is getting married. And all of us, we congregate to give praise unto God. So thank God for the mercies in your life. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise and thanksgiving shifts our focus from our difficult circumstances. I've already said. It gives authenticity to our Christian life. Praise and thanksgiving releases the supernatural. We know the story in Joshua chapter 6. Acts chapter 16. The Bible said that Paul and Silas were put in jail. They were put in jail for preaching the gospel. But the Bible said at midnight, Paul and Silas rose up and they began to pray. They began to worship. Their feet were in the stocks. They were put in jail. Not for any criminal thing they've done, but just preaching the gospel. But Paul and Silas recognized that they had a superior power. They recognized that they had a weapon that they can use for God to come into the situation. It isn't that God wasn't there when they were being arrested. They were doing the very work of God. You know, sometimes things happen to you when even you are right in the midst of doing what God has commanded you to do. It doesn't mean that God is not with you. My sister, my brother, sometimes the heat is heated a certain time when you are right there doing the will of God. Hallelujah. Paul and Silas engage this powerful weapon of prayer and praise unto God. And a miracle happened in their life. Hallelujah. The Bible actually records that there was an earthquake. So we go to that quickly. Acts chapter 16. From verse 25. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh Jesus, we thank you.
Thank you.
Acts chapter 16 from verse 25.
Thank you so much.
Brother Toby, thank you so much. I appreciate you. Thank you. But at midnight, Paul and Silas was praying and singing hymns to God. They were not having a pity party. They were not saying, oh, why me? What is me? Why me? I've been going to market. I'm there every Wednesday. I'm there every Friday. Every prayer night. Every Christian prayer night, I'm there. Wednesday, Friday, I'm there. Sunday, I'm there. I'm there every time. Right there, then Pastor Oloke. Why this? So we go back to Acts chapter 16, please. The Bible says that at midnight, you know, there's something happens. When we engage the midnight hour,
yes.
There's something that happens. When we engage the midnight hour, there is a mystery regarding the midnight hour. Believers must know how to engage the midnight hour. Even in your distress, in your circumstances, in your difficulty, engage the power of the midnight. The Bible said they were praying in the midnight, singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Next verse, please. Suddenly, there was a great earthquake so that the foundations of the prison were shaken. You know, when you engage that weapon of mass destruction, it creates an earthquake. And the foundation of everything that is going to hold you back, the prison cannot hold them back. As they engage the power of the midnight, the foundations were shaken. There was an earthquake. And the prison gates were shaken. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Immediately all doors were open. And everyone's chains were loose. That is how the earthquake will happen in your life. That is how the prison foundation should be shaken. That is how every door will be open in your life. Every situation that the enemy is bringing to hinder you, to help you in. Every situation shall give way as we engage the midnight hour with this power of prayer. God will visit you.
Amen.
in what may look like a prison. God may visit you in that situation. He will visit you.
Amen.
And that prison door will be open.
Amen.
The Bible said that, be ye lifted up. Oh, ye gates, be ye lifted up. And let the King of glory come. Ye everlasting doors, whatever door there be ye lifted up, that the King of glory shall come in. There is a King in you. There is a King in you. He is great as Jesus. Hallelujah. Those doors, those prison doors of poverty, I command them to be opened. I command them to be lifted up. Prison doors of ill health, I command you to be opened. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Every immigration prison door, every immigration prison door that is limiting the people of God, we command them to be lifted.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Bible says that the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof.
Yeah.
The earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. In the name of Jesus. Every caseworker that seems to have forgotten the people of God, this morning, Lord, we lift our voice up in unity. Lord, we call upon the name of Jehovah. For in the name of Jesus, let every case that has been forgotten be brought to the fore.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, show yourself strong on behalf of your children, O God.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for victory. We give you the glory. We give you the praise. Friends, there's power in praise. Praise and thanksgiving releases the supernatural. As I said earlier, the Bible said that Jericho was strictly shut. No man went in, no man came out. But God commanded his people, and they sent the levers to the front. And as they engaged in what God commanded them to do, not very long, that wall came down. That wall came down. So every wall in your life will come down.
Amen.
Every wall in your life will come down.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In this our season of power, every wall of Jericho will come down.
Amen.
In your life in Jesus. There are a few things that we want to look at briefly. Hinder in your praise and thanksgiving. Unbelief is one of them. Unbelief is one of them. You know, unbelief can cause you to focus on the circumstance, on the challenge, on the situation, rather than focusing on God. Unbelief can cause you to focus on the situation rather than focusing on God. There are a lot of scriptures, but we will not go to Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, in Numbers chapter 14, verse 2. Bible said that as soon as the Israelites came out of the Red Sea into the wilderness, they began to murmur and to complain. You know, because they've forgotten. They did not believe that the God that delivered them with an outstretched arm, who planted the Red Sea for them to walk through, they couldn't imagine that the same God who gave them water to drink. So they began to murmur, unbelief, unforgiveness, bitterness. You know, those things can hinder a lifestyle of praise and worship. Unforgiveness and bitterness. Ephesians 4:13, the Bible said that we should not grieve the Holy Ghost. And unconfessed sin. Proverbs chapter 28, verse 13. It says that who confesses and forsakes his sin shall be blessed. Amen?
Amen.
The flesh. You know, when your flesh is tired, when your flesh is exhausted, the flesh just wants to sleep. You know, in Romans chapter 7, Paul talks about the flesh. He said, "What wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this, you know, sinful flesh?" The flesh, that's what we need to engage the spirit all the time. Now, broken fellowship with God, that also will hinder our ability to engage the lifestyle of praise and worship. We know the story in Luke chapter 15, of the prodigal son, when he left his father's home, he couldn't commune with the father anymore.